Hello, fellow teachers and students of the scriptures. Welcome to Teaching with Power. This is Ben Wilcox, and I'm so grateful that you decided to take this time to study the scriptures with me this week. And this week, my friends, we begin our study of the Sermon on the Mount, which I consider to be the greatest masterpiece of all Christian literature. So we as teachers have the unenviable task of preparing to teach a lesson on the greatest lesson ever given. I mean, it's almost tempting to just say to your class, if you want a great lesson on the Sermon on the Mount, go read the Sermon on the Mount. I mean, who are we to add to Jesus' teachings? Or to try to give a sermon on the sermon of sermons? However, that being said, we know that that's not really our role as teachers, to just send our students in to study the scriptures on their own. In fact, we're hoping that they've actually already done that homework before they've come to class, and now they're ready to come and discuss it and learn a little bit more about it. But wow, it's a tough week to teach because there's so much you could talk about. It's like trying to dig down a mountain with a spoon. Jeffrey R. Holland said this. He said, "The masterful Sermon on the Mount, 6.5 pages that would take 6.5 years to teach properly." Well, we're going to try to cover some thoughts from it with the understanding that we're not going to do it justice. As a teacher, you're not going to do it justice, and you're not meant to. So just relieve yourself of that anxiety. What I try to do is just cover some highlights and do a few things well, rather than trying to do a lot of things poorly. You'll also notice that I don't spend time in Luke 6 this week. Many of the stories that we read in that chapter are going to be covered in other weeks. And Luke 6 also contains many similar teachings to the Sermon on the Mount, and is sometimes referred to as the Sermon on the Plain. And there are some nice additional thoughts on the teachings of the Sermon on the Mount given there. And so I encourage you to read it after you study Matthew 5, and look for what it adds. But we're not going to cover those things here. And one more note, you might notice that some of the thoughts and ideas that we talk about here sound familiar to you. And that would be because if you studied the Book of Mormon with me a few years ago, Jesus teaches almost the exact same sermon in 3rd Nephi to the Nephites. So you'll see that I'm going to approach teaching it here in a similar way to how I taught it there. Although we do get into a little bit more depth here, because the Book of Mormon lesson covered the entire sermon in one lesson, whereas here, it's divided into 2 weeks. And so with that said, grab your scriptures and your marking pencils. It's time to dig deep. And for an initial icebreaker, I just like to ask my class a simple question. Is there anyone out there who's the type of person that likes to read the last page of a book first? And almost inevitably, there are usually at least a few people who do this, or who have done it before. And then I ask them why. Why do you like to read the last page of a book first? Some of the answers that I've gotten over the years are because I like to know if reading the book is going to be worth it. Or I don't like surprises. I don't like the wait. And then because it lets me know what the whole book is leading to, or what the book is going to be about. Regardless of what kind of person you are, today we're going to approach Matthew chapter 5 like that. We're going to start with the last verse first, which I feel is going to reveal what the rest of the chapter is all about. So please read Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, and what does it say? "Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect." Now that verse can sometimes give us fits, and we say, really? Does he really mean that? It couldn't be. Do I have to be perfect in order to go to heaven? And the surprising answer to that question is, yes. Technically speaking, we do have to be perfect in order to enter the kingdom of God. We know from the scriptures that no unclean thing can enter the kingdom of heaven. The Lord cannot look on sin with the least degree of allowance. Celestial beings are perfect beings, meaning without sin. But before we throw up our hands and say, well, I might as well give up now, then, let me rephrase the question. Must I be perfect in this life in order to go to heaven? And the answer to that is, of course not. So what does the Savior mean here, then? Let me just give you three thoughts on this. One, take a look at the footnote for Matthew 5:48b. And that tells us that the original Greek word used here can also be translated as complete, finished, or fully developed. Therefore, one way of looking at this verse is to say that Christ is inviting us to strive towards completeness, to finish our course, or to seek to develop ourselves towards perfection. It doesn't mean to be without sin, weakness, or faults. And then if you look also in that footnote, you're going to see that it sends us to Doctrine and Covenants 67, verse 13, which reads, "Ye are not able to abide the presence of God now, neither the ministering of angels. Wherefore, continue in patience until ye are perfected." And that sure seems to suggest that this is a process we're talking about here. We become perfected over a long period of time. Grace to grace, line upon line, precept upon precept. And that process is going to require what quality? Patience. Patience in who or what, particularly? Patience with ourselves, patience with the process, patience with others who are also on that path and require time to become what they're capable of becoming. And then perhaps my favorite cross-reference for this verse is Doctrine and Covenants 76:69, where we also see the word perfect used in the scriptures. And it's a verse that describes the kinds of people that will inherit celestial glory or exaltation. But how does this verse use the word perfect? It says, "These are they, the souls who inherit the celestial glory, who are just men made perfect through Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, who wrought out this perfect atonement through the shedding of his own blood." Now, how do you feel this verse sheds light on our understanding of Matthew 5:48? What is it that's perfect? It's the atonement that's perfect, not us. And that perfect atonement is what makes it possible for us to be made perfect or perfected in patience. And what kind of people are made perfect? Just people. And that means righteous people. So if I want to go to the celestial kingdom, I don't have to be perfect in this life. I just have to be just, right? I just have to be just. And then Christ's atonement will come along and perfect me, make me whole or complete, fully developed. I believe that's Christ's intent with the Sermon on the Mount. He's going to teach us how to do this, how to be just. And since that's how the chapter ends, everything that comes before it is going to help us to learn how to be just. Jesus is going to teach us how to be just. And that's fitting, because Jesus himself is the greatest example of justness. In a sense, what he's doing here is revealing his own character. He's translating who he is into words for us. Since he is the Word made flesh, here we see him making flesh the Word, so that we can understand it and we can live it. And as we study the Word, I believe you'll notice that the things taught in the Sermon on the Mount are focused on who we are as Christians rather than what we believe as Christians. The Sermon on the Mount is not a big list of tenets or policies or even doctrines so much. It's a discourse on what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, who we are meant to be, not just know or believe or even just do. It's a sermon on becoming. So speaking of becoming something, Christ begins the sermon with a set of verses that have been labeled the Beatitudes. And that's verses 1 through 12. And that word derives from the Latin word beatus, which means to be fortunate, to be happy, or to be blessed. You can see that in footnote 3a. And I like that idea in conjunction with what we just talked about. Because yes, the sermon is about becoming just and righteous and Christ-like. But what will that becoming lead to? What's the attached result of living that way? Happiness and blessedness. We'll be fortunate. Righteousness always was happiness. In fact, that's another way that you could approach this entire sermon. We go through and we look for all the things that are going to make us happier. If I control my anger, if I control lust, if I love my enemies, if I'm not judgmental, if I treat others how I want to be treated, I'll be happy. And I suggest we approach these first 12 verses as a marking activity. First, have your students find all the blessings in verses 1 through 12. That's where I like to start. And with that, we create a large list on the board. And here are the blessings. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. They shall be comforted. They shall inherit the earth. They shall be filled. They shall obtain mercy. They shall see God. They shall be called the children of God. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We see that one once again. And great is your reward in heaven. These are the promises for becoming more like Christ. And do they look like pretty good wages to you? And after listing those blessings, I ask them which blessing they would most like to receive and why. And then we do the other half. If we wish to receive these blessings, then what must we do? What attitudes must we develop in order to be happy and blessed and fortunate? Then have them mark the attitudes in a different color. If we do that, we find we need to be poor in spirit, mourn, be meek, hunger and thirst after righteousness, be merciful, be a peacemaker, be persecuted for righteousness' sake. And he goes into a little bit more detail on that one. Be reviled, persecuted, and have all manner of evil said against you falsely, for his sake. These are the attitudes and conditions under which we can be happier. Now, I know that some of those conditions aren't conditions that we would normally consider to be blessed. Being poor, mourning, and being persecuted aren't usually considered to be fortunate states of being. And that's the thing about Christ's gospel. The world's definition of blessed is different from the Lord's. It requires a higher or a more eternal perspective. Every single statement in this section is a lesson in and of itself. And you could dedicate an hour or more discussing each one, what they mean, why the Lord wants us to live that way. In a class, you probably won't have time to do that. But you could ask your class if they have any questions about the meaning of the Beatitudes. Be prepared to answer those. And allow me to give you just a few brief insights that you might want to include in a discussion of the Beatitudes. What does it mean to be poor in spirit? I don't think Matthew is using the word poor in terms of how much money we have in our bank accounts. I believe that both rich and poor monetarily can be poor in spirit. I think it means to be humble, submissive, reliant on God. These are the people who know they depend on a power higher than themselves. Just like those who are financially poor are more likely to be humble and willing to reach out for help from another source. Those that are financially rich are more likely to be tempted by pride and a feeling that they don't need anybody else, including God, to help them. The JST adds an important phrase to that verse. It adds, "Blessed are the poor in spirit who come unto me, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." They go to Christ because they humbly recognize that there are things that money simply cannot buy, that know that they need Christ every step of the way, and that God is the source of everything that they have. "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." Mourn for what? Is it just referring to the mourning we undergo when a loved one dies? believe that's included. What greater comfort does one have in that position than a knowledge of the resurrection? But could it mean more? How about mourning for our sins, or for the sins of those that we love, or the grief we feel for whatever trials life throws at us? I believe this promise of comfort applies to all of that. Also, keep in mind that being comforted does not mean living a comfortable life. We're talking about an inner peace here, peace in the eternities. I really love the beatitude in verse 6. Blessed are they who do hunger and thirst after righteousness. I love that description. One of the qualities that will make us most happy is to desire righteousness, to hunger and thirst after it. Think of a time that you were really hungry. After a long day of work, fast Sunday? Or how about thirsty? Have you ever been dehydrated and all you wanted was a cool drink of water? Do you feel the same way about choosing the right? Do you desire righteousness like you do food or drink? Wonderful thing about our Heavenly Father is that in His judgment, He takes our desires for righteousness into consideration. He even says that in Doctrine and Covenants 137, verse 9, which contains my favorite punctuation mark of all Scripture. He says, "For I, the Lord, will judge all men according to their works." But what punctuation mark follows? Is it a period? No, it's a comma. Thank heavens it's a comma. And I love that comma. Because if it's a period, you and I are in a great deal of trouble. If I'm only judged for my works, I don't think I'm going to make it. But there's something that's going to be added to the judgment, not just my works. What else is He going to consider? According to the desire of their hearts. My desires do count for something. I know that sometimes it's said that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. Apparently, so is the road to heaven. And that's something I hope that we can honestly say about ourselves, that we want to be good. It's just that our works probably aren't always good. But maybe if our desires are also considered, and the Lord is going to lay those on the scales of judgment, maybe we stand a chance. The promise for that beatitude? They shall be filled. But the JST adds a nice phrase to the end of that. They shall be filled with the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost will help us to choose the right. One more thought. What does it mean to be a peacemaker? I think it's more than just being somebody who breaks up fights. It means being the type of person that brings peace to others through the service that they give, the comfort that they offer, the gospel message that they share, their happy and gracious attitude. Through these things, they distribute peace throughout the world. They're peacemakers. So that's just a few thoughts on some of the Beatitudes. And our truth here, as I seek to reflect the qualities of the Beatitudes, I will be more happy, fortunate, and blessed. And to liken the Scriptures, you might invite them to ponder the following application handout. It lists the 8 Beatitudes and a description of what living that Beatitude might look like, and then offers them a chance to choose 2 that they feel they're doing well at, and then encourages them to choose 2 that they feel they could work on. So here's the descriptions. Poor in spirit. I recognize my need for God and Christ in my life. I seek to be humble, and I give God the glory for all my blessings, talents, and gifts. For mourn, I feel godly sorrow for my own sins and the sins of others. I recognize that grief over sin, death, and trials is a part of mortality, and maintain my faith in a loving God while in those circumstances. I seek to mourn with those that mourn. Meek, I'm teachable and submissive to God's authority. I have a great degree of self-mastery and control with the powers and gifts that God has given me. hunger and thirst after righteousness. I have a great desire to do what's right, even when I don't always do so. I want to be good. I want to know God and to do His will more than anything else, including my own pleasure, status, or success. Merciful. I can forgive others. I don't always have to retaliate or get even. I don't focus on the shortcomings or weaknesses of others. Pure in heart. I strive to do the right things for the right reasons. My life is marked by openness and integrity. Peacemaker. I work hard to bring peace to the lives of those around me through service, comfort, sharing the gospel, and having an attitude of gratitude. I seek to help those around me to work out their differences constructively and without fighting. In persecution, I'm willing to stand for truth and righteousness and my testimony of the gospel of Jesus Christ, even if it means persecution, ridicule, or suffering. And with that, I invite them to ponder what they could do that week that they feel would help them to develop that quality or those qualities more fully. Joseph Smith once said that happiness is the object and design of our existence, and will be the end thereof if we pursue the path that leads to it. Well, Jesus has just given us a great idea of what that path looks like. These qualities, known as the Beatitudes, are certain to bring us the happiness that they promise us. Let's be all that we can be by living the Beatitudes. All right, now, following the Beatitudes, we have an incredibly motivating section. It's like Jesus really wants to build us up and inspire us before he gets into the meat of the higher law. So he's going to give his disciples, which I hope includes you and me, a vision of what we are, or what we're meant to be. And he's going to compare his disciples to three different things, each one helping us to better understand our identity and our purpose. So for an icebreaker, I do an object lesson. But before I pull out the objects, I ask my students to read Matthew 5, 13 through 16, with the following two questions in mind. What three things does the Savior compare us, his disciples, to in Matthew 5, 13 through 16? And what two warnings does he give to his disciples in these same verses? And as they answer that first question, I pull out the objects. And the three objects are salt, light, or a candle, I put those two together, and a city set on a hill. So as the answer, I pull out a jar of salt and a lamp, and then usually I'll display a picture of a city on a hill. And then what are the two warnings that he gives? One, as the salt of the world, don't lose your savor. And then two, don't put your light or candle under a bushel. Now we can build on these ideas. Why do you think he would compare us to those particular objects? Pick at least one and explain why he would want us to be like that object. Why salt? Well, what does salt do? It brings out the flavor or the savor of food. It makes things better. What does God intend his disciples to do with the earth? To make it better, to bring out the goodness. And the JST changes the wording of this a little bit. It says, I give unto you to be the salt of the earth. Like, it's a gift. It's a privilege to be put into this position. I picture God up there with a jar of good souls, looking down at the earth and saying, things look pretty bland and bleak down there. I know what I'll do. I'll sprinkle it with these great souls. These noble and great ones, this generation that I've reserved for the last days. And he tips it upside down and starts shaking the salt of the earth. And we fall down to the earth. And hopefully as we land here on the earth, we bring out the goodness in it. We lift others up. We make their lives better. Help them to savor their lives. But remember the warning. If the salt shall lose its savor, the salt shall be thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and trodden under the foot of men. I think that what he's saying here is if we, as his disciples, fail in our commission to bring out the best in the world, then what good are we as his disciples? What good did it do him to save us for the last days? We've got to be different from the world. If his disciples are just like everybody else, and we mirror and reflect the attitudes and behaviors of the world, then we're not doing the good that we're supposed to be doing. The salt is not going to have its desired effect. Also consider that in Christ's day, salt was used to preserve things and was also used as an antiseptic to heal things too. You could explore that symbolism with your students. How do we preserve the world? How do we heal the world? Well, why a light or a candle? Light guides, light comforts. Light reveals obstacles in the way. Light stands out. It dispels darkness. Then we've got another warning here. What should we not do with the light that we have? We're warned not to put our light under a bushel, but rather on a candlestick. So what does he mean here? Don't hide your light. I think sometimes we don't wrestle so much with the desire to be good, but we're worried about letting everybody else know that we have that desire. We'd rather just fade into the background and sit under our bushel instead of letting our light so shine before the world. A bushel is a basket. We sometimes want to put our little basket over our head and just shine our light in that small space for only ourselves. So we say, Lord, I do want to shine my light, but is it okay if I just shine it in here? So nobody else needs to know? Nobody needs to know my standards? Nobody needs to know that I'm different? The problem with that is what will happen to a candle if you do cover it or put a basket over it? I remember one of my kids, I asked that question in a family home evening, and they said, it'll light the basket on fire. And yes, I suppose that's possible. But more likely, the point I think being made is that it will eventually go out. And isn't the same true spiritually? The less we're willing to shine our light, the more we hide it, the dimmer and dimmer it becomes. On the other hand, what happens when we put it up on a candlestick? The answer is in verses 15 and 16. We give light to all that are in the house. And when they see that light, those good works, hopefully it helps to lead them to glorify their Father who is in heaven. And so we do get a little bit of an interpretation of the symbolism there. The light is our good works, the good things that we do. So just like the salt, it's about blessing others as well as ourselves. And the Book of Mormon adds to our understanding of that light. In 3 Nephi 18:24, Jesus says, "Therefore, hold up your light that it may shine unto the world. Behold, I am the light which ye shall hold up, that which ye have seen me do. Behold, ye see that I have prayed unto the Father, and ye all have witnessed." So what is the actual light that we're holding up to the world? It's Jesus Christ. The things which we have seen him do. His good works become our good works. When we seek to act in the way Christ would act, we're holding up his light to the world. And here I find it a good place to share a modern example of an individual who let their light shine. Perhaps you could share an experience from your own life with them. A time when you had the courage to stand up for what was right in front of your peers, your co-workers, or family members even. What happened? What gave you the strength to do that? And what effect did it have? Or invite your students to share a time when they or someone they know let their light shine to the world. I might share an experience that I had in high school where I was in a computer class and the teacher left the room And while she was gone, I saw a crowd of students starting to form around one of the computers. So naturally, I went over to go see what was up, and one of the students had connected to the internet, which was a fairly new concept back in those days, and was bringing up a pornographic picture. And I decided right there that wasn't something I was interested in seeing or taking part in. So I turned around and walked back to my desk and didn't think much more of it. But at church the next Sunday, a young lady from my ward that was also in that class walked up to me and passed me a note. And in it, she thanked me for being a good example, and that when she saw me walk away from the group, it gave her the courage to do the same. We never know who's watching. We may never know the impact and influence we can have on the people that surround us. If we let our light shine before men, it may very well lead them to glorify God and give them the strength to do what's right as well. Our third symbol. How are we like a city set on a hill? Again, it can't be hid. It's out in the open for all to see. And also, in ancient times, cities were built on hills as a defensive strategy. It placed you on the high ground and made it much more difficult for your enemies to attack. We too can find protection from the adversary as we unify ourselves with other saints in his holy city on the high ground of our beliefs and standards. And one more clarifying thought before we continue. Is the major thrust of these verses that we're just awesome, that we're so much better than the rest of the world, that we're favored above everybody else? No, I don't think so. This is not an invitation to self-righteousness or pride. Because what good is salt all by itself, without any food for it to flavor? Do you like to eat salt plain? I might even pour some salt into my hand at that point and ask if anybody would like to come and try. They're probably not going to want to do that. What good is a light if there's nobody to see it? What good is a city set on a hill if there are no citizens to live in it? God loves all of his children, so he calls his disciples to bring goodness and light and protection to all that they can. This is a call to lift others up, not to look down on them. He's calling us to influence and to share and to invite. So our truth here, if I seek to bring the good out in others and the world around me, and let the light of my example and testimony of Christ shine, and seek not to hide my good works from others, then I may lead them to glorify God. To liken the scriptures, how would you describe the light of your life right now? A flickering candle, a steady campfire, or a blazing furnace? How could you add fuel to that fire? How could you increase the wattage of your light? Now, I encourage all of us then to be that salt. Be that light. Be that city on a hill. Let's not be ashamed of who we are or what we believe. If you bought a fancy new sports car, would you hide it in the garage and leave it there? No. Women, if you bought a beautiful new dress or some nice jewelry, would you just leave it in your closet? No. So let's do the same kind of thing with our example and our faith. The Lord needs us to show the world who we are and what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, and how happy it makes us, without any self-righteousness or pride. Let's reach out and bring goodness to the world around us. We've been sent to this earth at this time for a very special purpose: to be witnesses of Jesus Christ at all times, in all things, and in all places. And if we can catch the vision of that, of who we are, then brothers and sisters, we will be a great force in this world for good. And now, speaking of vision, to introduce the final section of Matthew chapter 5, I like to give my students a few examples of the importance of making progress in talents, in sports, interests, or any other endeavor. Choose something as a teacher that you love and that you're good at, and share with them how you've gotten better at that thing over time. Maybe even bring in some of the things that you use in your talent. I like rock climbing, and different climbs are given different ratings of difficulty. So I might bring in my climbing gear and talk about this process I went through to become a better climber. The first climb I ever attempted was rated a 5-6, and it was hard for me. The next time I went climbing, I did another 5-6, and that continued for some time until they became quite easy for me. Then I tried 5-7s, and then 5-8s, and on up the scale. But what if I had decided to myself that since I knew I could climb them, that I was just going to spend the rest of my life climbing 5-6s? Could I ever consider myself a great climber? No, I wouldn't. How about playing the piano? Could you ever consider yourself a great piano player if all you ever practiced was chopsticks and Mary Had a Little Lamb? Could you ever consider yourself a great basketball player if all you ever worked on was dribbling and layups? If you're into video games, would you be satisfied if all you ever did was play the first level? No. In any endeavor that we care about, we seek to improve. We try harder and harder things and aspire to be greater and to become more skilled. I believe that's the spirit of the rest of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is gonna try to lift us and them to the next level of discipleship. Give us a greater goal and vision of who we can become. I think that's what he means when he says in verse 17, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." Jesus wasn't overhauling the law of Moses or changing the decrees of God. He was seeking to raise his people to the next level. If I'm walking up steps, I don't destroy the step below me in order to move up to the next. It remains there as a foundation. The people of Christ's day still needed to live the Ten Commandments and the principles upon which the law of Moses was based. But now it was time to lift them to a higher law, to the celestial law. The law of Moses was a bit more terrestrial in nature. Sometimes, as an illustration of this principle, I'll take one of my students' desks and stand on the seat of it and say, "If this seat represents the law of Moses, something that raised the people above a telestial or a worldly identity, then the Sermon on the Mount, or the higher law, would be taking them up a step." And at that point, I step up onto the desk. Very carefully, mind you. Don't hurt yourself if you try this. Make sure that the desk is really sturdy. And just say that this is what Jesus was doing with his people. Or you could bring a ladder in to your class and do the same thing. Now, did Jesus destroy the other step below him as he introduced them to the higher law? No, it's all a part of the same structure leading us back to God. The law was created to help us to get closer and closer to our Heavenly Father and our own divine potential. Now, I think you might be a little surprised by Matthew 5 if you haven't really dug deep into it before. I believe that you're going to find that the higher or celestial law is really challenging. I think we sometimes pat ourselves on the back for being good people because we don't break certain commandments. And that's good that we don't break the commandments. God's very pleased that we don't. But we shouldn't just stop there and be satisfied with that. Jesus is always seeking to lift our sights higher. So to help my students better understand that lifting of expectations and why it matters, I teach the higher law against the backdrop of the plan of salvation and the 3 degrees of glory, because that's an idea that we're a little more familiar with. As a non-Jewish audience, we may not relate as well to the Mosaic Law, Higher Law model. Therefore, which kingdom would the higher law be associated with? The celestial. The higher law is the celestial law. People who break God's laws are living a telestial law. But terrestrial law is a little harder to pinpoint for us, though. That middle kingdom. What kinds of people go there? It's always a little bit more difficult to explain that. The Sermon on the Mount can shed some light on that for us. You're going to notice a pattern in the language of Matthew chapter 5. Some flag phrases that you should look out for. It hath been said, or it hath been written of them of old time, or something like that. And then, but I say unto you. So in other words, Jesus is saying, they used to say this, but I say this. I'm raising the bar. I'm taking you to the next step. And I like to provide my students with this handout to help them identify and understand that pattern. The first example of it comes in verse 21. Ye have heard that it was said of them of old time, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. So they used to say, don't kill. All right, I think we can all agree that murder is wrong, right? But compare this to the laws of the degrees of glory. If I kill, what law am I living? That's a telestial law. But if I go throughout my life and I don't kill anybody, what law is that? Well, that's just a terrestrial law. If I live my entire life without murdering somebody, then I've lived a law that will gain me at least a terrestrial kingdom. But what is the celestial law? Verse 22. But I say unto you, that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. So the celestial law is, don't even get angry. Don't insult your brother. Raca was an insult that meant empty-headed. Now that's a little bit of a tougher law, isn't it? So we might be tempted to say to Jesus, I've gone through my whole life without murdering anybody. Aren't I a good boy? And he says, that's good. I'm proud of you that you haven't murdered anybody. But can we raise our standard of righteousness a little higher than that? Can we take it to the next level? Let's seek to control our anger and our words. That's a celestial law. And in that, do you see that he's not destroying the law like the Pharisees are accusing him of? The rule not to kill is still in total force. But that next level of discipleship is to control anger. Also, there's an interesting phrase that's removed by the JST from this verse, which makes it even harder. Can you find it in the footnotes? Yeah, footnote 22b tells us to omit the words without a cause. And, oh man, I thought I was going to be okay with this one because as long as I have a reason to be angry, well, then I guess I'm justified, right? I just shouldn't be angry without a cause. But nope, the JST comes along and says, no, you control your anger even if there is a cause. And I could just imagine some little translator or monk somewhere in history looking at that verse and saying, oh, he can't actually mean never get angry. What if someone really has given me a cause to get angry? Then that's okay, right? And so he casually adds the words, without a cause, to the verse. Who knows how that phrase got in there? But do you see how this pattern works? Let's try it on another one here. Verse 27. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. Okay, there's the Mosaic law. So if I commit adultery, what kind of a law am I living? That's telestial. If I don't commit adultery, what law is that? That's terrestrial. But watch how Jesus lifts us higher. What's the celestial law? Verse 28. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her, hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. The celestial law is to not even look upon another person with lust in your heart. So they used to say, control your actions, but I say, control your thoughts. It's a bit more challenging. Avoiding pornography would certainly apply here. That would be looking on a person to lust after them, wouldn't it? I imagine most of us listening here could say that we're probably doing pretty well at living the terrestrial law in this. But do we struggle with living the celestial law? Now you take that pattern and you try it yourselves with some of the other examples on the chart. And if you do that, here's what you might find. In verse 33, again ye have heard that it hath been said by them of old time, thou shalt not forswear thyself, but shalt perform unto the Lord thine oaths. The law here, keep your oaths. And back then, an oath was a very serious commitment. If you made an oath, you were expected to keep it. So if you broke your oaths, that's celestial. If you kept your oaths, your special promises, that's terrestrial. But what's the celestial law? But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Neither shalt thou swear by thy head, because thou canst not make one hair white or black. But let your communication be yea, yea, nay, nay. For whatsoever is more than these cometh of evil. And I'll admit that this one's a little bit harder to understand. But what he's saying is that you shouldn't have to make oaths. Don't swear by anything to assure people that you mean what you say. Don't swear at all. By God's throne, by the earth, by your own head. I suppose somebody back then might say, I swear by God's throne that I will keep this commitment to you. And that was your way of showing that you were really serious about keeping your promise. But the celestial law is let your communication be yea, yea, or nay, nay. In other words, let your yes mean yes, and your no mean no. No need to add all this swearing business to show people that you're in earnest. Always be in earnest. Say what you mean. They used to say, keep your oaths, but I say, keep your word. Another one, verse 38. Ye have heard that it hath been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Now, the way that many of the Israelites interpreted this was as a law of retaliation. And if you remember back in our Old Testament study, we saw that this phrase is really more about restitution than retaliation. But based on how Jesus is applying the higher law, it's apparent that they were using it to justify revenge. So the idea is, don't start fights. Don't be the aggressor. But if they start it, you're justified in getting them back. But make sure that your retaliation is just. What's the celestial law then? I start the problems. I'm the instigator. I throw the first punch. I sow the seeds of conflict. The terrestrial law? I only retaliate when somebody else started it. But what's the celestial law? And this one's really challenging. I know you've heard it before. But I say unto you that ye resist not evil. But whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. Well, now if that's easy for you, you're a better person than I am. They used to say, make sure your retaliation is just. But I say, forget your retaliation. Turn the other cheek. Don't feel the need to get them back. Our next one, verse 43. Ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. What's the celestial law then? I just hate everybody, including my neighbor. But the terrestrial? I love my neighbor, the people like me. But I'm justified in hating my enemy. What's the celestial law? And I know you know what's coming, and it's a really hard pill to swallow. But I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. And then he continues to teach the principle, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. For if ye love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? And if you salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans so? In other words, if you only love the people that love you, the people that are like you, how much better are you than the people that we would consider to be evil? Even Osama bin Laden had friends. God expects us to do and be something more than just your average person. We're not only going to pray for the people that we love, but for the people who don't love us. And how many of us have really attained to that level of discipleship? Probably not a lot. It's a hard one to keep. But Jesus is going to walk the walk and talk the talk, isn't he? Can you think of a time when he prayed for his enemies? Or for the people that persecuted him? Yeah, you might remember that while on the cross, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So the celestial law is really quite a high bar, isn't it? And a warning here. I don't think the takeaway message from this is, if you aren't living the celestial law exactly as it's described here, then good luck ever getting into heaven. That is not the spirit of this. Remember what we started talking about right at the beginning. This is not about being perfect. This is about striving towards perfection, about being just, about hungering and thirsting after righteousness. Jesus hasn't just handed us a set of clubs to beat ourselves down with. So why do you think he is doing this? Why set the bar so high? He's giving us inspiration. He's giving us a target to aim at. And no, we're probably never going to reach it in this life. His atonement is going to have to take us there eventually. But he needs us to be moving in that direction. We don't want to plateau in our spiritual progress or feel like we've arrived in this life. He doesn't want us to settle, rest on our laurels, or be satisfied with our current performance. That's why it's set so high. That way, we're always going to have something to work on, inspiration to move us forward. We can be pleased with and celebrate our progress and our successes, but still remain uncontent with our current state of being. Just like I do with rock climbing, or you do with basketball, or playing the piano, or whatever you spend your time working on. We can always get better, and hopefully we want to. Living the gospel is not meant to be a checklist, but a quest, a mission, an epic journey towards Godhood. And hopefully this chapter has just provided all of us with some ample inspiration. So our truth here, we could use all of our outcomes that we've discussed so far today in our principle. As I strive to live the higher law, the happier I will be, the brighter my light will shine, the more just I will become, the more Christ-like I will grow. Some questions you might consider asking. What teaching from the Sermon on the Mount did you most need to hear today? And has the Spirit prompted you in anything that we've studied? Was there a little voice in the back of your head at any point during the lesson where you thought to yourself, I need to do better at that? And the other question, is there anything that you plan to do differently because of that? And I'd like to conclude this lesson with two quotes, one from C.S. Lewis and one from Joseph Smith, because I feel they really capture the spirit of the Sermon on the Mount. So C.S. Lewis said, "The command, be ye perfect, is not idealistic gas. nor is it a command to do the impossible. He's going to make us into creatures that can obey that command. He said in the Bible that we were gods, and he's going to make good his words, if we let him, for we can prevent him if we choose. He will make the feeblest and filthiest of us into a god or goddess, dazzling, radiant, immortal creature, pulsating all through with such energy and joy and wisdom and love as we cannot now imagine. A bright, stainless mirror which reflects back to God perfectly. The process will be long and in parts very painful, but that is what we are in for, nothing less. He meant what he said. And then the prophet Joseph Smith, here then is eternal life, to know the only wise and true God. And you have got to learn how to be gods yourselves, and to be kings and priests to God, the same as all gods have done before you. Namely, by going from one small degree to another, and from a small capacity to a great one, from grace to grace, from exaltation to exaltation. When you climb up a ladder, you must begin at the bottom, and descend step by step, until you arrive at the top. And so it is with the principles of the gospel. You must begin with the first and go on until you learn all the principles of exaltation. But it will be a great while after you have passed through the veil before you will have learned them. It is not all to be comprehended in this world. It will be a great work to learn our salvation and exaltation even beyond the grave. So that's how I hope we can all approach these teachings. Let's continue onward and upward, getting a little better each day, month by month and year by year, and realize that this process of becoming like Christ and God will be long and challenging. But by the same token, let's not beat ourselves up or get impatient with our progress. We may not reach the highest heights of righteousness while in this life, but I believe we can get closer and closer to it over the course of our lives. And if we strive to do that, I believe with all my heart that Christ will lovingly take us the rest of the way. We will be perfected in Christ. But until then, let's just keep climbing those steps. And that's going to conclude our lesson for this week. Boy, isn't the Sermon on the Mount amazing? And I've got some good news. There's more. Right? There's still two more chapters of the Sermon on the Mount with incredibly wonderful, inspiring, challenging things for us. So that's what we'll do next week. Teachers, if you are interested in the resources that I create, go to teachingwithpower.com and you'll find links to those resources. And if you found that any part of this lesson was helpful to you, I encourage you to share it with somebody else that you feel it could help. So thank you, everyone, so much for watching. Now get out there and teach with power.